so much trouble.
Hey guys, I'm about to go live in a minute. Hey Marcia. Hey everybody. Wendy, I'm so excited for you tomorrow. Hey Wes, how are you? Hey Valerie, James. Hi, everybody. Hi, Miss Grant. So listen, I'm asking. Hey, Donnie, I see you was at the Eagles game. Look like you paid a grip for those seats, too. We're about to get started. What time is it? I got about a minute. I'm going to give you guys some time to log in. Hey, Jason, how are you? Hey, Rise, I'm going to actually need you guys to be interactive with me tonight. Tonight's going to be a really great show. So be patient. We're about to log on. Is it 6:45? Yep, it's 6:45. Hey, hey, hey. Hey everybody, it's Christina Harris on Business, Faith, and Family. You are tuned in to Spiritual Connect Radio. It is Friday. It is cold outside, but I'm thankful it's Friday and it's the weekend is here. Hey Renata, hi everybody for logging in. If you're listening through Spiritual Connect Radio, if you're watching via Facebook Live, tonight we are going to talk about your giving and how that coincides with your success level, whether that's your success in your business, in your life, with your healing, with your deliverance, whatever it may be. Tonight is one of those messages that I really feel like God has brought me a long way through. So I want to encourage you guys with a lot of what I've learned over the years. We're going to come from out of the Bible. But before I start, today is Friday, and I want to actually just give a moment of silence, actually. About 16 years ago, my cousin, Roland Gardner, also known as Mac for many of you, was killed today. So I want to just ask that you keep my family in prayer. It's still tough for us dealing with that. You know, he was the pillar of our family, and we miss him so much. So I want to just, you know, and shout out to my Aunt Jube, Aunt Julie Wallace, for just being strong over the years and just for help raising our children. You know, I know that was your only son. So I thank you for your strength, and I love you guys. So thank you for that, everybody, for allowing me to just be able to take those minutes. So we're going to get into it. And again, we're going to talk about, hey, Samaya. Hey, Rel, thanks for logging in. Tonight, I'm going to start reading. And as I said, we're going to talk about how you're giving. And basically, I want to just say this, if I can sum it up. Thank you, Wes. I appreciate that. If I can sum it up, what I've learned is, and what I want to teach you guys, is there's a difference between having a heart for God and therefore sacrificing whatever it is that he give you, whether it's your tithe, your time, or whatever. And then there's your tithe. And tonight we're not actually going to get into any like religious debates or theological principles, but I want to show you, even in my own life, how I've moved from just simply tithing, because that's more so of a command and obedience, to giving unto the Lord. See, when you give unto the Lord, there's no cap. There's no 10%, because God is so much worth more than just 10% of his own resources. So tonight we're actually, I want to come out of a different story in the Bible. A lot of people overread, don't value as much. And this is where I pretty much have learned the principle of giving unto the Lord. So I want to read this book. I want to read this verse to you guys. A lot of you probably be surprised that I'm going to come out of here. But I want you to be open-minded. And I want you to see that no matter how successful you are, it all starts with God first. You know, as a business owner, as a mother, whatever it is, your success is determined by your level of how much you're willing to give God, of yourself, of your finances, of even of your family, your children. How much are you willing to give God? So I'm going to start in Genesis chapter 4. And this is the story of Cain and Abel, one of my favorite stories. And let's do away with the fairy tale story of Cain and Abel. Let's get into what really happened, you know, on this day. It says in Genesis 4, we're going to start at chapter 4, verse 1. Now Adam had sexual relations with his wife, Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, "With the Lord's help, I have produced a man." Later, she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground. When it was time for harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lamb from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked at dejected. "Why are you so angry?" the Lord asked Cain. "Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you. But you must subdue it and be its master." One day, Cain suggested to his brother, "Let's go out into the fields." And they were in the fields. Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Afterwards, the Lord asked Cain, "Where is your brother? Where is Abel?" "I don't know," Cain responded. Am I my brother's keeper? Some translations say, "Am I my brother's guardian?" But the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out from the ground. Now you are cursed and banished from the ground, which has swallowed your brother's blood." So we're going to stop there for now. We're going to pray in real quick. And we're going to open this up and see how can we level up our lives, like come up higher in our level of success by giving our first to God, you know. We're going to pray in. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for allowing us to get through this week. We thank you, Lord God, for allowing us to see another day. Therefore, you still have purpose on our lives. Father God, I ask that you help us to bring this word into our hearts, Lord God, so that we can do better and just be more givers, Lord God, not just because you've asked us, but because we want to, Lord God. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Amen. So the first thing I want to point out to you guys is a lot of people, I remember just hearing the story of like Cain and Abel, and yes, you know, Cain killed Abel. But I never really knew why. And I remember growing up just thinking that Cain was just like, you know, this awful guy and just was jealous. But as I started to read this story, I actually see why. And here it says, when they grew up, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lamb from his flock. It said, the Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. And this made Cain very angry. I don't know about you guys, but have there ever been a time when you probably kind of looked around at somebody else's life? It was like, man, God is really blessing them and God is blessing their crop. And, you know, they're really like they're harvesting during harvest time. And this is kind of what happened. This is what happened in this story. You know, you have Abel, who would give God his first, the best of his first. And I want to say something real quick. First of all, right before this story, we do know Adam and Eve story was before that. So therefore, Adam and Eve must have taught their children how to give to God. Because I'm going to tell you something about this flesh and this body that we live in. The body is hostile. The flesh is hostile to the things of God. So giving is not a natural inclination. We are made to survive on the earth. So with that being said, I truly believe that Adam and Eve had taught Cain and Abel to be givers to the Lord. But even with you teaching someone something, there has to be a level of your own relationship that propels you to not only just give because you're told, but give because of that gratitude towards God. You know, I remember the first time I heard a message on tithing and giving was Minister Richardson over in Sharon Baptist Church. And he preached, and I was like, wow, like I really need to, you know, start giving. But then it started to turn into, and this is me being completely honest, you know, I keep it real with you guys. I started tithing because at first I was one of those people who was like, you know, this church is big and, you know, this pastor don't need this money. And I don't know what these people, you know, how we get into all the reasons why not to give. And let me tell you something. When you doing what you need to do, when you worried about your seeds that's in the ground, you don't have time to worry about what other people are doing or what they're not doing. Now, by no means am I saying not to have discernment and common sense. If you are fellowshipping at a church that has no electricity and you know the members are tithing and things are just happening financially and, you know, you use your discernment. But however, what I'm saying to you is this. There was a time where I felt like I used to spend more of my attention focusing on what everybody else was doing or perhaps were doing. Therefore, I was actually only blocking my blessing from being obedient to God first and foremost. Secondly, I want to say to you guys, hey, Miss Mary. Hey, Uncle Ty, how are you? It's such a pleasure to see you up here tonight. So, as I was just saying, I want to remind you guys that there's a big difference between when you give God out of because you're supposed to and when you give God because you genuinely want to give him. You know, there's a lot of people who I would kind of just get a little complacent in my own life sometimes. And When I started tithing, I remember even being at a point where I would tithe and I started like counting how much I was tithing. And I remember one time, I will never forget this. I will never remember one time, Sunday morning, I'm, you know, counting all this money. And at that time I had all types of businesses. So I was racking up some really good money. So one morning I'm tithing and I'm counting up the money to put into the envelope. And I remember feeling like, you know, oh yeah, they're going to appreciate my tithing. And I will never forget the Lord convicted me so much so. And he said, why are you counting my money? And I remember like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. See, because God knew it wasn't that let me count so I could put the amount on the end. It was that, oh, like out of that pride, that pridefulness. And I admit that I had to repent from that. So I see, and that's why I thank God for being like completely real with us when we do things, even inwardly, that we, you know, what otherwise other people wouldn't see, that's called iniquity, those secret hidden sins. So I thank God for revealing that to me because that completely humbled me. So now when my tenants pay me, the money just goes right into the savings account until Sunday or whatever it is. But sure enough, as I said before, he convicted me and he said, why are you counting my money? And I remember feeling like crap because I was like, wow, you know, like sometimes no matter how, what level of grace we are at, we could still, you know, it still be some of us in there. That's why I always say it's so good to always check your motives. Check your motives before God has to. You know, the Bible says, show yourself approved, you know? So, as I was saying that, and remember, when you give unto the Lord, it's more so of a mindset. And that's where I hope that you guys be, because when you start to give, it's no cap. And God is so great that not only do he only ask for 10. See, when you start making some real money and when you really experience a high level of success, you start thanking God that he only asks for 10%. All right? You start thanking God that he only asks for 10%. But look how good God is, that he even allows us to write it off on our taxes. Like, come on. Come on, you know? So I say all that to say, when you develop a heart for God, when you develop a mindset, and when you really want to see to be successful, and this is a lot of times, and I'm going to keep it real with you guys. A lot of people, they come to me and they want to own a business, but they want to own it for the wrong motive sometimes, you know? I want to own my own business because I'm mad at my boss, you know? Just because you're mad at your boss, that doesn't necessarily qualify you to become the shepherd over other people in a sense. Because sometimes we still have that character issue that God is more so interested in helping us to work out before we get to that next level in our life of whatever, even if it's entrepreneurship or ministry. I just heard Joyce Meyer say, we are in a season where you can become saved today and then want a pastor tomorrow. So that's why I always encourage, don't rush your process. I don't care if it's your process with your family. I don't care if it's your process in your business. When I first started out my business, it was more so out of a all about me. It was about my gifts, my skills, my capability, my education, all about me. I didn't really give too much attention about whether I was being the best employer to my employees and things like that. It was just all about me. But as God has been so faithful and committed to helping me get through this process called life, and this process of being a big girl, I've learned that it is nothing, has nothing to do with me, has nothing to do with me, and all about you guys. You know, when I get up here and I drive all the way to the station to come and be a blessing to you guys, I don't get paid for this. But guess what? I'm all right with that because this is me sacrificing my availability to God. There's times like last week, I didn't want to do my show. You know, I didn't want to do my show on Friday and the enemy was kind of, you know, really wrestling me. But out of my love and my commitment, which sometimes we all fall short at, I wanted to do this because of my love for God. There's not too many ways, like God isn't interested in how much you give him, it's his. And I remember this year, I want to share this story with you guys. This year, I went through some financial hardship that I haven't had in a long time. And I remember the first thing I did was like, hold on. Am I, Lord, did I do something wrong? Like, I'm tithing. Like, you know, what's wrong? And I remember God dealt with me about not the 10% that he had taught me to be a better steward and give. But he dealt with me on the other 90% of my income. And he dealt with me on how I was conducting like my businesses, how I was spending my 90%. You know, I was overindulging in my dining experience, I'll say. I spent a lot of money in food. And, but I was wasting seed, in other words. For me, it is food. For some of y'all, it may be clothes or something else, you know? But, God had basically told me, Chrissy, for this next season that I'm about to send you to, I need for you to grow up with your finances. Because, see, the Bible says that much is given, much is required. And also, you have to learn to be a better steward over the little bit of seed and never get complacent. Right now, you know, I may feel like, all right, I'm good. Do you know what I mean? Financially, I'm good. But God wants to send me to another level, even financially. But if I don't know how to handle my level of success now, He's not going to be pressed to send me to my next level. So tonight's message is mostly about, I want you to look at where you are. I want you to look at how you've been giving. Even if you don't go to church, guess what? There's plenty of organizations who would love a charitable donation. And your job is to be, you know, diligent as far as, you know, a credible organization. But your job is just to release the seed. Release the seed. I want to teach you about the principle of seed, time, and harvest. That's a principle that whether you in church or not in church, whether you believe in God or don't, that's a principle that's still going to be applicable for your life. So it depends. And I want to ask you this question first. What is your harvest? What is your harvest going to look like in the next season? I want you to think long or hard about it. What is your harvest going to look like in the next season? Your season may be next week, next month, next year, but the next season, what is your harvest going to look like? And you know who determines what your harvest looks like? You. You. You determines what your harvest will look like. Will you have plentiful? Because, see, your harvest in the next season is determined about how well you did with your seed in this season or previous seasons. You know, I don't really stress about money. You know why? See, when I was a babe in Christ, I used to. And I'm not going to say that sometimes I don't get a little like, oh, you know, but I don't stress about money as I used to before. And one of the reasons why is because I feel that in my relationship with God, that I've been walking with Him enough that I really believe in my heart that God is faithful. And if there is a time where God may have my finances a little rocky, it's not because He don't want to give me. Most times I have to stop and ask God, Lord, is this something you want to show me that maybe I'm overlooking, something I'm not doing? When God gives you an increase, it's so important for you to be especially sensitive to the next instruction, because most time the increase is for other people as well, you know? And I have that gift of giving. So most times when you have the gift of giving, God always give you increase, extra, because He knows that you are trustworthy to give to the person that He gave for you, who's in need, you know? So I want to just ask you guys again, can God trust you with His seeds? Can God trust you with His seeds? And how is your harvest going to look in the next season of your life? And that all depends on your giving in this season and your previous seasons. So, and it's never too late for you to start. And listen, I want to read this to you. I want to read this to you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And as I said, a lot of people don't come from the book of Genesis when they talk about giving. But I think this is the first and probably one of the best stories that tell you about giving your first fruit kind of to the Lord. What did God tell Cain? He said, why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain. Why do you look so dejected? Here we go. You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master. Do you think that if for once Cain was so focused on his brother's blessing, so much so that he became angry and jealous and sin started crouching at the door to the point where he killed his brother? And a lot of us, we'd be we so stuck when we think about the story of Cain and Abel. We be just thinking about he just went off on his... He killed his brother because God blessed Abel's harvest. He blessed Abel's harvest. How many of us do that? You can look at the next person's life, blessings, husband, wife, businesses, or church even, and start hating to the point where now God is having to check you with your motives. God is having to check you with telling you, setting you back on the right track. Never get to that place. With God, first of all, you can't really miss a blessing from God unless you're not at the right place. And this is times when people are not at the right place. So I don't want you to be a Cain. I don't want you to be a Cain and you're looking at everybody else's life, wondering why God ain't blessing you, or why God blessed that person too much, or why God blessed that ministry above yours. You need to be focusing on, all right, Lord, am I in a place of submission? Even in my finances, am I in a place to receive all that you have for me? So I love this story. I love this story because, and it goes to show you this. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you how good God is. And this is the part where we always overlook. See, we only see what God, we only see the act of God when he has to reprimand the sin in us and reprimand us. But we never look at the graceful, merciful, loving Father in the midst of it. Don't you know when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden? All right, we all know that they got banished from the garden. But don't you know before they left, God was so loving and still a father that at the end of the day, he still clothed them before they left, you know. And even here with Cain and Abel, how many of us with a show of hands? I'm going to read this to you. How many of us with a show of hands since Cain killed Abel? Poor Abel ain't had nothing to do with nothing. He was just giving unto the Lord his first fruit and being a good son. And here comes Cain with his hating self, right? How many of us would agree with a show of hands that the punishment that God had for him probably was sufficient enough for taking another's life? But listen what God does. He says, this is what Cain says. Cain replied to the Lord. Now, hold on. I'm going to go back to verse 12. He says, the Lord says, no longer will the ground yield good crops for you, no matter how hard you work for it. From now on, you will be a homeless wanderer on the earth. Cain replied to the Lord, my punishment is too great for me to bear. You have punished me from the land and from your presence. When I first read that, I was like, wow, you know? Wow, I'm going to get back to that. He says, my punishment is too great for me to bear. A lot of us would be like, hey, you just killed your brother. Oh, well, right? To be honest, let's be real. He says, you have made me a homeless wanderer. Anyone who finds me will kill me. Now, look at God, rich in mercy. The Lord replied, no, for I will give a sevenfold punishment to anyone who kills you. Then the Lord put a mark on Cain to warn anyone who might try to kill Cain. So Cain left the Lord's presence and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Now, listen. Don't you know for years I always thought that mark on Cain was because he killed his brother? But it was a mark of protection from the Lord. So that goes to show you, no matter where you are in your life, I don't care what kind of sin you indulge in. I don't care how long you've been away from the Lord. I don't care about any of those things. This goes to show you how rich and merciful God is. See, God doesn't choose. It's not a desire for God to punish us, but he has to reprimand the sin that lurks inside of us. But even with that being said, God is still so rich and faithful to us. That's why I always say God's love never fails. This is a father who loves his kids. And I'm so blessed to be a part of that. Now listen to this, right? I don't mean to get deep with y'all. That's not my intention. But I want to share the revelation that God has given me. A lot of us, we say that a lot of us, we say that when Adam and Eve sinned, they were banished from the garden, remember? So therefore, they were no longer in the presence of God, remember? Well, listen to this. How is it that God is able to say, how is it that Cain is able to say, you have banished me from the land and from your presence? You have made me a homeless wanderer. Anyone who finds me will kill me. And it says, so Cain left the Lord's presence and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. So we all know that Adam and Eve was kicked out of the garden. And we know that they had children, which was Cain and Abel. But they was apparently still had access to the presence of God. See, no matter whether you were in your Garden of Eden, and see, the Garden of Eden may have been a place there, but remember, you too have access to that Garden of Eden. You have access to the throne of God. The Bible says, come boldly to the throne of God. You still have access to the presence of God. So you would have thought because Adam and Eve was banished, they was no longer had the presence of God. But see, God couldn't stay away from his children. He still gave them access to him. And Christ came to give us access to the Father, to the throne of grace. So don't take that for granted. Don't take that for granted. Let me finish my message. In Proverbs 21, verse 27, it says, the sacrifice of an evil person is detestable, especially when it's offered with wrong motives. Hey, Kia. Hi, beautiful. You know what? Have you ever had somebody give you something and it seemed like it was a nice gesture, only for them to turn around and tell everybody of what they gave you and throw it in your face? I'm pretty sure we've all have been there before. Well, let me tell you something about God. It says he will detest your sacrifice. The Bible says, listen, God isn't as interested as in the sacrifice opposed to you, one, go and make things right with your brethren. He would rather for you not to sacrifice just because you're a lot of us, we tithe or we give, but it's from the wrong motive. The Bible says, leave your sacrifice at the altar and go make it right with your brother or your sister, your mother, whoever it may be, that coworker, you know, whoever it may be. God honors relationships. And more importantly, God would rather you keep that sacrifice and do something honorable. Do something honorable. So the point of the message tonight is to help you to develop a spirit of sacrificial giving for the Lord and not just the tithe, not just giving a little something here and there. See, because when you start to have a sacrificial heart for God, when you really love him and therefore, Lord, I'll give you everything. I'll give you all of me. I'll give you my time. I'll give you my gifts, my skills, my resources, my children, my family, my spouse, even after I've prayed for him, I'll give you all of me. See, that takes you to the level of success to a whole nother level. And then see, God will be able to trust you. And therefore, he will have no issue blessing you. God is looking for people like that. And I just pray that you really look in your own life and see what's your level of giving. Where have you been in your level of giving? And can you come up higher? And I promise you, the Bible says that God will repay you for giving to the homeless, the lonely, the widow, the sick. God himself will repay you. And I believe that with all of my heart. He may not bless you back with finances. He may bless you with more time on this earth to spend with your children. He may bless you with more, with a higher position to produce more seed for you, you know? So I believe that with all of my heart. I want to read this to you guys real quick. When I was reading the study portion, it says, God evaluates both our motives and the quality of what we offer him. When we give to God and others, we should have a joyful heart because of what we are able to give. We should not worry about how much we are giving up, for all things are God in the first place. Instead, we should joyfully give to God our best in time, money, possessions, and talent. How many of us can honestly say we have been giving God our best? Our best, you know? Not what's left over, because I don't want nobody's leftovers. And I don't want God to give me no leftover mentality of a blessing. So therefore, I don't want to do that to him. As we teach our children, treat others as you want to be treated. Don't think that we are exempt for how we treat God with what he blessed us with. Listen, there may be times when you question him coming through in a timely manner, but as I even say, even when it comes down to being with money, it's our job to be a good steward over it. Most times it's not that God didn't provide. Are we doing what we're supposed to have done with it? Are we doing what God gave us the blessing with, you know, to do what we had asked him to do, you know? Wes, that was, I got that out of my study portion for Genesis 4:3-5. And I want to say to you guys, like I said before, when you have your own dreams, aspirations, your own goals, your own level of success, whatever that may be. Hey, you may be a successful stay-at-home mom. You help them kids get their homework done. You're helping them to be God-fearing children, whatever it may be, or a home, or a dad. Listen, there's more single fathers. There's more single fathers becoming, you know, more the thing I'm starting to see. So I don't know if we're going to be able to hold that anymore, ladies. But the bottom line, what I'm saying is this. As you give God your best in your gifts, your skills, your talents, your resources, you can't go wrong with that. And when you worried about your own seed, just worry about your own seed. Don't worry about everybody else. Don't worry who's giving what at the church. Don't worry what the pastor is or is not doing. That's his business. That's what he has to be accountable for God, because you're going to be accountable for God for the seed that's in your hand. So why take on the stress of somebody else's business? I wear a lot of hats, and by no means do I want to add any more, okay? I don't want to add any more. So I learned to stay in my lane and mind my own business. Mind my own business. Another thing I want to show you guys is, do you see how quick in the scripture that when sin had entered the garden with Adam and Eve, how it wasted no time, no time. It came into their children's life even afterwards. And that has to be a hard pill to swallow, to have one son kill the other son over, let's bring it into modern terms, having one son kill another son over some money, because that's what it was about. It was harvest time, and God blessed Abel in his harvest. And why? Because Abel gave God the best of his firstborn lamb from out of his flock. So I want to say to you, as parents even, or caregivers, let's not forget that we are accountable to what kind of sin that lurks in our household. You know, I always say, don't play with sin. A lot of us, we know that spirit of perversion is in our family, is in our household. And guess what? it will surely invite itself into the next generation. A lot of us, we know that spirit of alcoholism or verbal abuse, physical abuse is in our family. And it will surely come into the next generation. So I want you, as we just seen, I want you to be mindful of what kind of generational sin that may be lurking within your four walls, you know? Another thing, too, is don't just read the Bible, as I said. Don't just read the Bible. When you read the Bible, I want you to take your time. And the first thing I want you to do is ask God to minister to your spirit first. Ask God to give you revelation. Illuminate your mind and what you know. And then ultimately, and this is when healing takes place, when you ask God for that first, God will start working in your life that now you can sincerely bring someone else to where you have been, because now you've moved past where you was. So even in your level of success in business, listen, there's a lot of times now I get to the point, if somebody want to open up a business, if someone need real estate, investment advice, whatever it is, just give me a call. See, yes, the Bible says your gifts will make room for you. And rightfully so, even as a certified coach and all those things, I have the right to charge. But guess what? God takes care of me. And I don't have to penny pinch people. I don't have to, well, you know what? I'm going to withhold this information because you don't have it financially to pay me. Listen, if it's something that you genuinely want to do, send me an inbox or a message and I'll help you as much as I can. I ain't talking about financially. It depends, you know. But if it's, you listen, knowledge is free. It should be. There's a quote that says, and it's one of my best quotes, one of my favorite quotes. It says, the gift, the purpose of life is to discover your gift and to give it away. When you realize the big picture, see, the big picture is that we're not going to be able to take any of our blessings with us. Only the blessings that you do for the kingdom. Those are everlasting blessings. But anything that we have down here on the earth will stay. It will stay. So I would rather help you guys and enrich you. For example, when Renata comes on Friday morning on her day off to come and encourage you guys to get through to the weekend or help you get back to a place, that's her blessing you with her gift, her skills, her talent. When Wendy is writing beautiful songs to inspire your children, help them to psychologically, developmentally be well-rounded people, that's her giving her gift, her skill for your children's sake, you know? When Siobhan, when any of us here, when we're doing our gift, or when there's someone who, you know, we see it all the time, someone bless you, and you say, what's this for? Just pay it forward. Just pay it forward. And like I said, you may not necessarily have to, if you're not in a church, you still can sow a seed into someone's life. You know, my father does contracting, and he has had his construction business for over 20 years or something. And don't you know he never once advertised for it? He never once advertised for his business. You know why? Because see, before my father ever was even assigned an EIN number, he was already planting seeds of his talent. He was already helping the old lady at the block with her plumbing issue and ain't even want to charge her because she's old and he know that she ain't had nobody to do it for her. He was already planting seeds, and God made sure that that man ain't one for nothing. If any time, there would be times where he would have too much work that it wasn't enough for him to go around. And that's where I want you to be. I don't want you to be worrying about where the next seed comes from. I want you to focus on the quality of the seeds you currently have and how you're going to plant them. Seed, time, and harvest is a principle that's in life, period. Whether you have a business, whether you have a ministry or whatever, it's all about how well you do with your seed in this season of your life. Another thing I want to say is, when we move from religion, see, religion says give a tenth. Relationship says you can have it all, Lord. Religion says give a tenth. But relationship with God says you can have it all. I'm withholding nothing from you, even myself. I posted earlier, what's the greatest or what's the best sacrifice you can give to the Lord? And I firmly believe in my heart, the best sacrifice that you can give to God is yourself. Yourself. Let him heal you from those things that you need to be healed from. So you no longer keep doing the same thing over and over again. Let him build your spirit back up. Let him use you like you've never been used before. Let him bring you to a place where you can fulfill all those dreams and goals you had, you know? Let him give you some godly desires and take those old ones that's dragging you down away from you. He'll do that for you because he's done it for me. So I know he can do it. I also want to tell you guys, there was a time when I first started buying property, right? When I first started buying property, I was more focused on collecting my rent and things like that, you know, the financial gain of owning those houses, that I wasn't really willing to do, like, go above and beyond. And let me give you an example. By no means was I a slumlord, but I would do just enough. If they needed a refrigerator, you know, I'll just go buy a nicely used one, you know? And that's, you know, most times that's wisdom. Because, you know, they steal them or, you know. But in other words, what I'm saying to you is this. God had to teach me how to not be a person of just enough. Because I don't want God to give me just enough. I want him to be that overflowing, increasing God that I know that he is. But I don't want him to give me just enough. So I was doing just enough in these properties to just maintain and make the tenant happy. But I know I wasn't doing my best. You know what I mean? I wasn't going above and beyond. And God showed me that this year. He showed me that this year. And I thank him for that. Because after he taught me that, boy, did the windows of heaven open up. It overflowed and not only my finances, but in my home, with my children, with my mother, with my family, with my friends. He just really blessed every area of my life, you know? And I'm excited. See, now when God bring things to me to repent about or change, I don't allow the enemy to make me feel condemned. If anything, I get excited because it's a new level of grace that I'm about to go up to, you know? It's like the elevator. We're going to the top floor, you know? Before you can make it to the top, you got to ride past 1, 2, 3, 4, and all the other numbers in between. And it's okay. It's okay because God is going to teach you so much along the way. So much along the way. So enjoy the ride. Enjoy where he has you now. The Bible says, don't despise small beginnings. And I don't know where you are in your life right now. And I don't know where you are in your finances. But I promise you that your success will grow the more you give yourself to God, the more you are a giving person, period. I used to be a selfish woman. I used to be very selfish. I only worried about myself and what you were going to do for me. You know, I grew up with the take mentality. My grandma had, we had a large family. So Listen, when she said come eat, you better have, y'all better run. We would be running down them steps to go eat, because in about 5 minutes, there would be no more food, okay? we had a large family. And, you know, just thinking about that just had me bring back some great memories, you know? But I say all that to say this. Don't be complacent because you feel like you should be farther in life. You're right where God wants you to be. You're right where God wants you to be. And not only are you right where God wants you to be, He knows where you are and He knows how to get you to that next level. You know? He knows how to get you to that next level. And enjoy your time here on the earth. Life is so short. And God doesn't owe us anything. He gave us His best when He allowed Christ to come and die for our sins. Sins He didn't even commit. And I thank God so much for His sacrifice. Because if I didn't have His sacrifice, and if I didn't have the peace that surpasses all understanding, knowing that I'm going to heaven, all right? If I didn't have that, I would be, I don't know where I would be. I don't know where I would be if I knew that my life after this wasn't certain. I don't know where I would be. So I thank God for giving me the certainty. I thank God for giving me His Holy Spirit that resides in me. I thank God for all the heavenly blessings that we don't even talk about. I thank God for all of that. I thank God for my family. I thank God for you guys, you know, and my children. And one of the ways that you can give God is to have a heart of gratitude. You ever meet an ungrateful person? I've met people in my lifetime that don't say thank you. One of my pet peeves used to be, you know, you open a door for somebody and you hold the door. You're holding the door for them and they walk right through the door and don't say nothing. They don't even say thank you. You just want to hit them on the back of the head. No, I'm joking. But that used to be a pet peeve of mine, to have someone not say thank you. But guess what? When I started to change my perspective, because you can't change what people are going to do or not going to do. But when I started to change my perspective and no longer expect a thank you, it wasn't affecting me anymore, you know? So I want to just remind you to have a heart of gratitude for the Lord. It's not that God doesn't want to bless your business. That's not the issue. God is more so interested in who you are while conducting business. Are your scales fair? How do you treat people? Do you charge them an extra $50 just because they won't know the difference? How are you conducting business? It's not that God doesn't want to bless you with a husband. Maybe you have some healing you need to do first. Maybe you need to prioritize Him first. Because, see, He may bless you with Mr. Right. But will you be willing to give Him back as a sacrifice so God can use him? Or are you going to be selfish and keep Him all to yourself out of your own insecurity and out of your own codependency? So, that's why I say your giving will determine your level of sacrifice. Your giving will determine your level of sacrifice. And as I said, you can always come up higher in your giving. I love this story. When you get a minute, I want you to read it. We're in Genesis 4, verses 1 through 16. And you should be reading your Bible regularly. You know, the Bible is the word of God that washes away so much in our lives. You know, it washes away wrong thinking. It puts you back into that grand scheme perspective on life. So you don't get caught up in the details that's going to wear you down, you know. And I encourage everyone to just you know, read your word and allow God to meet you right where you are. I don't know. I'm pretty much finished my message, and I'm going to get done a little early because I'm grateful for the time that you guys give me. And this message didn't need a whole hour and 15 minutes. It's simple. It's very simple. Move from religion and move into a relationship with God. And if you don't know God, if when I say that to you, when I say relationship, you don't know exactly what that means. What that means is, despite where you have been, despite who you are, your upbringing, what may have happened in your life, your past, what you're indulging in, or who, despite any of that, there is a God, the creator of everything, who has made it his will, his purpose to love you. He sent his son Jesus to die for you. So if you don't know him, I'm going to lead you into the prayer of salvation, and then I'm going to pray over all of you guys because I want God to bless you richly. And not just, see, I don't want him to just bless you with money. See, because when you have the knowledge, the skill, but more importantly, the grace, money is easy to come across. You will always be able to make money. But God is more so interested in your character. Your character. Your character. Be a person of character. We all hate shady business owners, shady ministers, whatever your title may be. Be a person of great character. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, I thank you, Lord God, for teaching me to be a good steward over what you've given me, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that you constantly provide for me and my family, Lord God. I thank you that all my needs are met according to your glory and riches, Lord God. Father God, I pray right now for everyone who may be listening, whether through the radio or on Facebook Live. I pray that right now, Lord God, that you continue to give them the wisdom. Lord God, give us a heart like Solomon, where we ask you for wisdom and not riches. But bless us anyway, Lord God, because you are a God of abundance. You are a generous God, and we thank you for it, Lord God. So teach us how to be good stewards over what we have and even the people in our lives that you put in our lives, Lord. Father, if there's anyone who does not know your Lord Jesus, the Lord Jesus, for the pardon of their sins, I pray right now that you soften their heart. I rebuke you, Satan, right now in the name of Jesus, that I bind any stronghold that may be spiritually hindering anyone from coming to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. I renounce any lie of the enemy right now in the name of Jesus. So, Father God, I ask if there's anyone who's ready to receive you as their King, as their Father, as the God that can fix it, they can pray after me. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe that you died and you rose for me on that cross. I believe that you can forgive all my sins. And I ask you to come and live in me. I ask that you write my name in the book of life, that I may dwell in your house forever. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you guys. I pray that you have an awesome weekend. And be warm, drive safe, and don't forget to download the Spiritual Connect Radio app so that you can take me with you, even if you're on a train or over in another country. In addition to that, please like and share the video. Hey, Ira, how are you? I got to check out one of your classes. And make sure, again, make sure you guys support Wendy tomorrow. And Ira, can you post your information on this post as well? I love you guys. Rel, you got to tell me about the movie from yesterday. All right. I love you guys before I get all emotional. All right. Have a good day. Bye.